Yeah, that's a very official, the all-around poetry guide for Eau Claire. Actually, there are quite a few of those, and not all guys either. But anyway, we'd like to welcome folks here. This is also the first live event of the festival this year, and which is really wonderful. And we started this. This is a poetry conversation. So what we'll do, we'll have one poet will read a brief selection, 20 minutes or so of poetry. Then the next poet will read, and then we'll have a kind of moderated discussion. I'm really interested today because the two poets, Angie, Trudell, Vasquez, and Dorothy Chan, just met. So they're going to get acquainted right here. And I do know their poetry somewhat, but that will be fun. And we'll talk, and I will try to stimulate some conversation, things that might be useful for the audience to know. I really want to thank people for coming. This is the 127th annual Nadine St. Louis. It's been going on a long time. Might not be that. Nadine was a great patron of the arts. One of those people who started poetry late in life. She taught Shakespeare and writing and science fiction at the university here for a long time. And this is her last book, Zebra. And anyway, so she would have been here. She helped start the festival itself. And this is, we're always remembering her when we have this event. I have a little bit of, there's some protocol. I guess I should, no one else mentioned it, but we want people to turn off their phones here. I'm looking around here at a lot of people who I've seen at readings, giving readings and talks. I'm the only person I know of whose phone went off in the middle of his own reading. So I'm not gonna really check mine very well, particularly. I won't exactly have time for individual questions, but there will be some time at the end. The poets will come to the back where they have books, and the books are very much for sale, and they will be happy to sign them, and any questions that you're dying to hear answered by the poets will be right back there. I'll try to get us wound up in time for that, for you to have a chance to meet each of the writers. I wore my grandfather's watch today, the first time I've worn a watch in about 20 years. I'm not sure which grandfather it belonged to. It's either the one who drank and smoked all this and lived to be 86, or the one who went with a shotgun trying to find my mother and father after they eloped out of high school. So, either way, it tells time. Also, it's the birthday of Samuel Taylor Coleridge, famous poet, who once said, this is our only poetry event of the festival, which we need to probably remedy next year, but it's a double decker. Coleridge once said, prose is, the definition is words in their best order. And poetry are the best words in best order. So you tell which side he came down. It's also, besides being the birthday of Samuel Taylor Coleridge, it's the birthday of Carrie Fisher, Princess Leia, who once said, instant gratification takes too long. And also said, resentment is like drinking poison and waiting for the other person to die. So those two things, literary giants, possibly more about Carrie Fisher a little bit later. And in case you haven't been attuned to the news today, the stock market rose almost 750 points today. I credit it to this reading. Can't prove that, but it makes sense to me. I'm gonna introduce the first one. I think I'll have Angela read first. I'm gonna do a little perfunctory introduction here. You can also read these in the program, that this sort of stuff. Angie just came from Madison today. And some of my questions are going to address parts of this biography. She's a poet, writer, editor, publisher, and activist. She's the current poet laureate of the city of Madison, which I think sometimes is a 2-year, but I believe you're on for the 4-year stint. Good. Madison also, I believe, has one of the oldest poet laureate programs for any city in the nation, so it's a big deal. She got her MFA in poetry from the Institute of American Indian Arts in 2017. Her poems have appeared in many places. During the pandemic, every time I turned around, there was an anthology with Angie in it, or she was putting it together, or I was seeing her on Zoom. And so it's been very busy during that particular time. She's an editor, and she's really, even before being poet laureate of Madison, I always knew of her as a facilitator for poetry and in the community in particular. So that's one thing that I knew about her. She has a new book, My People Redux, which is back there, which I'm interested to hear some poems from. And I have other questions, but I'll save those for later. But I'd just like to introduce, first of all, and welcome Angela Trudell Vasquez.
Thank you, Max. And I don't know if we've met in person, but I think we have. I'm sure of it. Yeah. So I was at the Library of Congress a couple weeks ago, and I got to see Ada Limon become the first U.S. Poet Laureate as a Latina. And she brought all her books because she couldn't leave them at home. She felt bad about it, even though she didn't read from all of them. So it was very special. I went with Kimberly Blazer, one of the former Wisconsin poets, Poets Laureate, and she had an extra ticket. And she said, I thought of you, and I'm like, yes. So I have a day job. And I quickly changed everything to go. And we had a special reception, we met her father, and then we got to go through the secret door to go to the main library, or to the main auditorium. And it was really interesting because every time you took a step, you would sink because so many feet have gone on that marble. So it was a very special, special event. And I'm gonna start with a little something from Yellow Medicine Review. I guest edited an edition of spring of 2019 with Melissa Kingburn. And it was on identity and language and body and boundaries and borders. So I'm just going to start with my essay, the first paragraph. My first language is English. I read, write, and dream this tongue. I do not know my original dialect, what my ancestors spoke before they left the mountains for the village that led to the middle of Estados Unidos to me. Spanish, the vernacular of the conquerors, English the next. My Spanish is a work in progress. So I'm going to read a poem for our 500,000 dead before I read from My People Redux. And the mayor asked me to write this poem when we got to 500,000, and I know now that it's on a church in Hudson somewhere. Dispatches from Radar Hill. For the bus driver on a shift who left and never came back. For the nurse who beat breast cancer but not COVID. For her colleagues who remember that every time a Billy Joe song came on, she'd pump her fist in the air and scream, Billy! With joy and pure fan fury. For the receptionist who carries on with the fist pumping and shouts in her name. For her co-worker who told the story to us at her virtual funeral. For our elders in nursing homes who gave and gave to their friends and family, their community, buying all the Girl Scout cookies on the block, saving money for their grandkids' birthday, who will miss their own. For the teachers who taught until they could not, for the students who struggled to learn with them online, for the parents who remain after so hard without your best friend, ally, accomplice there with you by your side, an island snoring each night. For those who lost their best friend and never got to say goodbye, or goodbye was a 2x4-inch screen, this the last time you saw them alive. For the widows who take poetry workshops 3 days after their love dies. For those who remain carry the name, the people who remember their words, wit, wisdom, how they were scratch cooks, made chicken curry and rice, firemen and pinto beans, sweet potato pie, peach cobbler, took turns driving the kids to practice, stopped puddles in rain. Remember, remember, light a candle, say a prayer, a blessing. Some funny thing they said in a line when you laughed so hard you cried, but you didn't. That was a road trip, a family vacation when the back seat smelled less than fresh after a drive through the desert without air conditioning. These are the days of our lives, and to those who loved and lost, this poem is for you, for me. Let us mourn all those we loved who no longer breathe the spring air or get to see their first robin this season. The world is a lovely place when you care, and harbor a secret love in your heart for all things full of color, sound, and feathers, soft sheets, chocolate ice cream, puppy breath, baby chuckles, your face in the morning in the mirror smiling back, so alive. That's dispatches from Radar Hill. So my people redux. So I'm rewilding my backyard, and this comes from a prairie near us. And so I am trying to return it to prairie. It's interesting what comes up. But I'm going to start this with a quote by C.D. Wright. I am looking for a way to vocalize, perform, act out, address the commonly felt crises of my time. These are spiritual exercises. That's from Cooling Time. And she's an Arkansas poet who felt just as comfortable in the city as she did in the country. And I too feel that. I grew up in rural Iowa and with cornfields and in the city. So both. I lived in both. And I still spend my time in cities and in the country. So this is called They Could Be Sisters. Three girls with straight waist-length black hair go round and round the circle. They cycle, talk, sing, locks whip in their wake. Sunlight highlights red handlebar streamers. Spinning on two wheels, they split, jump, curves, catch air. To fly or flee or speed, perched high and free on a purple banana seat. This is where my power started flowing on a bike in the driver's seat. The three roll on grass when a voice echoes, shouting distance rules, close the drapes. So this is my poem for my family called My People Redux. It's in four parts. I come from second and third generation Mexican Americans from Iowa. They came up in the late 1800s with the Rock Island Railroad, so a lot of my work goes back and forth. My People Redux, one. Crossed rivers and high deserts before water jugs littered parched lands, rode motorbikes, carried comals, black and white photographs. Fought poor villagers on their homelands, went from high school to the front lines. Lessons on patriotism led to flag burning, joints lit, alcoholic stupors, streaking. A roll of the dice, heads I live, tails I leave. My people forgot they rose from the earth. Two, our great grandpa knew, he planted corn, rose, praying while he weeded and walked between his crooked lines, singing to the clouds to come, lay their rain music down, drum a new rhythm, tap the green stalks to grow. He wove a footpath from the back door to the smallest plant, whispering its name and fed his family with what he wrought from earth and aqua sky, what he coaxed between loam and hard copper hands. Three, his kind fingers twist of pears, peppers, slender green beans, husks of sweet corn, crab apples and peaches, what the white-tailed deer did not nibble. Bees buzz in their hive, lured by the burnt man who croons at dawn, by his wife who brings him pan dulce and black cream in the morning in her pink house dress and potato sack apron. Leather patched by sun in scarecrow clothes, muscles cling to his bones, never young. Family, a heavy wool blanket covers his sins in the heat. Blessed with grandchildren, they run in his rows, bring him home books he cannot read, pages telling a history he corrects after cartoons each day. Four, great-grandchildren search for his buried grave, armed with spades and hoes. So they know where they came from and can find their way back to the original place of green grace, mountain breath, stews cooked with seeds woven into a young girl's black braid sewn in the hem of her deer dress. That is My People Redux. This is Maize Maiden after Rexley Jim. Wait, chica, listen. Press knees, lips, ears to earth floor. Corn in the beginning, corn in the end. Green arms dance in rows. Ancestor whispers, shut pollen in wind. Years of plenty, stories fill bowls. Children grow long. Tomorrow's seeds rest indoors. But I want everyone to know I am still alive after Lorca. I blow about the trees, inhale dandelion heads, visit when you would rather pick up a rope than a pen. I come to you when you droop on stone steps, swim in your water, your food, your soil. My body floats in rain clouds, you breathe me through your nostrils. I am apple's flower scent, arugula's bitter taste, a malty sip of beer, the pungent God-giving aroma of morning coffee dripping. I swing on monkey bars, climb trees, sit on your shoulder, stroke hair behind your ears, and when you write late, kiss the air around your face. Just a couple more from this collection. I have driven in many bad snowstorms. This is Blizzard. Rolling blind, no white lines, no light, no streets. Snow beneath my wheels, 5 inches deep, I cannot see. Ice pelts me, where am I? My eyes search for a glimmer of green. Please let me be going straight, not crossing. Iowa ice storm legends, tree limbs crack through roofs. My car spins into a ditch, the shame right back with a stranger. We're stretched closest to home. I could be driving off-road, chasing death. Howling wind beats the gold car. Alone I pray, Hail Mary, full of grace. A child again chanting, chasing ghosts from my bedroom, or driving home with my parents on Christmas night in a storm. Ice roads, no sand trucks, no salt. My dad swerves, my mom grabs the wheel. We were crossing. Me, a kid in the back with my sisters. I cast the rosary over dashboard, bridge cover my savior, highway splits ahead, turn, steer, plow, metal, rubber against wet, take the next exit, tire spin, slip, carry me to bed. I know we've been there. It's so hard. So this is a poem for my niece, Raven, and she spends time in 2 different environments. Raven. My niece forged in the belly of her mother, island corn child, doughy flesh, white, unlike me. Seed of merchant sailor, Taino natives hiding in interior trees. Of pancake hands and tortilla mines, of plantain shaped in balls, fried pork inside. Curls the size of grapefruit's eyes of jade, crawling on her knees, she shoves her German shepherd away, as if he was a fly, not 150 pounds of flesh for desire. She began walking one day, tottering between piano legs, sofa couches. Her fresh skin springs back, unlike the hot churros sold next door. She laughs at her brother, plays with his cast-aside awards, looks less like my sister, more like her father's tribe, carries thumbprints of a people, down nostrils, black hair, green eyes. She will learn how Puerto Rico keeps getting stolen, how Mexico has risen, fallen, about blood in all soil. Living in the barrio, she shuffles between high-rises, skyscrapers, buses and doormen, valets, paletas, the Michigan Mile, mango sellers, condo dwellers. To live on this land with one heart is to breathe every day divided. So that's My People Redux. And I'm going to read a poem from In Light, Always Light. And I'm going to read a family poem. And this one, I went and sat on the graves of my family outside of Newton, Iowa. And what people don't know is that Iowa is full of dead Mexicans from many wars. And this is called Arboretum. And my mother used to take us and we cleaned the stones and she'd tell us about the stories of everyone behind them. So one time when we were traveling, I went and I sat on them, cleaned them, and tried to invoke them. And this is me imagining, but it's called Arboretum. Arboretum frames Mexican bones, bodies who built railroads with broken backs, raw hands. An 1880 census conceals us, carving holes in steel cars for light night air, hanging hammocks for sleeping wives to rock under galaxies. One woman rides the continent, follows her man from Zacatecas, thighs astride her clacking motorbike, belly swings on a swing, sways on the rails until... Where they lived in boxcars until kids were grown, where postpartum was unknown and unbalanced women got sent back. Where my grandma, her cousins hid on the school hill to eat quesadillas. Neighbors claim the old man rode with Pancho Villa when men in suits leap off skyscrapers in New York. Where my mom and Tia pretend not to speak English, teasing shopkeepers on the square. Where my dad ran cross country to escape those fences farmland until he broke a mahogany streak on burnt clay tracks. Where my uncle strove for bullets in Vietnam, dragging his buddy to the helicopter. And grandmothers trade apples for pears, fingertips and ashy wrists, dig out change at the market, dole out tortillas during meals. One hand on the open flame, one hand flutters, holds the blue house dress. Where peony roots divide on their own, sparking an arboretum of sweet pink light, whose perfume carries itself uptown to the courthouse with drafts and garlic and chile. Where my sister came, the day my grandfather was buried, water gushing graveside. And summers went bolting between family houses, rhubarb sticks dipped in bone white sugar, ropes and fiberns, treasure hunts in the gully. Where I visit now, water their parched Easter lilies as they lie beneath the grass, thank them for surviving Midwest winters, wars and lynchings, for firewood split, mole recipes on parchment, for raising people who love so much it hurts to swallow, for lessons on how small caramel women united overcome great sorrow, for sharing their one red lipstick and rose hand lotion when I was a girl flowering at his arboretum. So I do write happy poems. And I'm going to read this one. There is a woman who is my dance teacher, and I've danced with these same women since 2005, and she comes from Baldwin, Wisconsin, which I know is close here. But she has inspired many a song and a poem, and so there's many times we've danced and they end up becoming poems. So this is called Wild Prayer, and if she were with me now, we'd be dancing for you, but we're not going to do that. So this is Wild Prayer. Brown earth floors, brief feet, sweaty bodies. We glow, glisten, meet, leaping in mid-flight. The swivel in the mirror, we are magic dying, blooming in our bodies. Bare souls touch dread trees, arms raise, carry, twist. Praise all that sings. Praise goddess monkey teacher from up north who left to dance around hollow ground on the edge of blue sky lakes with sisters round and round. Every winter we dance along the Milwaukee River or Lake Michigan. And if you come across a bunch of women dancing in the woods, you know it's magic. So I spent many years working for the ACLU, and two of our former board members are here. And you two get the prize for driving the longest. So this is a poem that came from me, legal observing at a rally. And you know, we're there. But this, I think you're going to know where I'm at. But it was in Janesville. And I call this poem In Light, Always Light, because no matter what happens, I'm going to live in the light. And like James Baldwin, because I'm alive, I have hope. So In Light, Always Light, which is the title of this book. Grass strands gleam, weave, undulate from the window. The vendor screams, build the wall, lifts his hand, works the crowd, looks at me, sells more t-shirts. My mind waxes brilliant, wet glass wings, waves shine black my reflection. I am dazzled by the sun glinting off my cat's whiskers. He lays on his back, flanks flayed by the deck, half shade, half light. First graders play football on miracle carpet in our shared backyard. The smile on their faces when they catch it warms us, childless apartment dwellers behind glass walls. The poet reads a book of poems and walks to the park to think. She does not know what she is going to do, hike the sled hill or swing on the swing. If no children are present, she will swing until her stomach says no, then descend from her height among the treetops and head home. She circles the preserve, full of earth thoughts, falling leaf music, crashing, crushing sounds, and auburn smells flow up from her footsteps. She thinks, we spin on earth's axis, halflings of history. So I have a few moments, and I'm going to read from these books. On this, I'm so happy. It's poems that are translated into English and Chinese, put together by Lisa Lijos and Sylvia Cavanaugh. And there's just one I'm going to read from here, because I like it so much. And I wrote this for the Chicago Haiku Festival. It's called If. If God came back to Earth, she'd live in Chicago proper, by Lincoln Park or the water, for the languages and the good food, to heal the sick and homeless, find them shelter or medication, wash their feet and take them home. And I was really, really happy to do some bit faster poetry around Patrick Marsh, which is near our home. And I'm gonna read a haibun from there. And so this is called The Land Speaks, and it is about this place, the Patrick Marsh. The land speaks to me, calls from outside the car window. We pass valleys, hills, what glaciers made 10,000 years ago when people moved to the edges of newborn waters, where ice chunks broke off, became kettle lakes. The sign says basins where ice lay, depressions frozen in time, melt, mark the earth, become altered landscapes, birth novel plants where fish feed and frogs sing, and mushrooms grow round white saucer hats that tip over in spring from the weight of their halo christening. Blue indigo bunties fly by the stars, chart moonlight migrations while we humans sleep, our feathered friends leap, follow the call to move. Swans and geese congregate, see 16 pelicans preen, their necks dip to drink, undulate, herding fish in the water. They dance in rhythm, circle the prey, thin species. Their beaks lead fish to a net made out of ripples, bubbles of gas, of air, lethal concentric circles calling names unknown. Before telescopes, night watchers, moonshine parades, dinosaur return. Do you ever think when we eat chicken, we're eating dinosaurs? I think about that a lot. I do. I know. It's a poet's brain. So I'm going to read a poem. I studied with Allison Adele Hedgecoke, and there was a poem I was working on, and it said, you can't write absence. So her challenge was to me, you got to write about absence. So this is called, and this is my last poem before Dorothy comes up, How to Write Absence. And it's a love poem. How to write absence. A hollow cobalt vase. A bottle universe. Dirges sung at your funeral. Chiseled gravestone markers. Wood plate at supper. Rugged wheelbarrow still. Purple iris bloom short. Violet carpets cry out for your footsteps. Silent mothwings drink at night from the birdbath. Take turns with the bees. Fireflies, crickets sing. Ants dwell tunnels underneath, worms creep, churn dirt in their wake. Tonight we forget our worries, spoon sleep sound, kick off blankets, tug sheets. Cold at night, we lack insulation from the deep freeze. The earth hums, hello, goodbye, gracias, go to sleep. Agile light streams bend the glass, gourd, old orange dream, halos circle the bamboo floor you laid, new homeowner, with fresh knees, broad back. We wax for years with bare toes, feet, padded slipper soles, pet dander. Filial dust fills the cracks. Now you stir, make coffee, feed the mew cats. I cry, 5 minutes max, anticipate your absence. Nose smooth, torso flush smell at dawn. Write the scene where you come back. Thank you so much.
I'm going to introduce Dorothy Chan, I first heard Dorothy read. She came a few years ago to apply for a job in Eau Claire, and I thought, wow, this is a good reading. But what really won me over, I think she was reading from this book, Attack of the 50-Foot Centerfold, and when she got to the part where she mentioned the 1960 star Bridget Baslin, who plays Salome in King of Kings, I thought, you know, we must be the only two people in the Chippewa Valley. We both had crushes on Bridget Baslin. I'm suggesting that we might be co-chairs of the Bridget Baslin fan club in the Chippewa Valley. Yeah, whatever. But Bridget, if you don't know Bridget Baslin, watch King of Kings sometimes. But also, I knew her because they made a big blockbuster movie in Paducah, Kentucky, my hometown, once. Charlton Heston, it was a terrible movie. Every movie star was in it. Hal West was one. You can get a hint of what it was like. Charlton Heston, John Wayne, Debbie Reynolds, lots of famous people. But a 17-year-old Bridget Baslin was in it as well. She played an outlaw's daughter, and we lived in an apartment across from the Holiday Inn where the movie stars stayed. And one of the bravest things I've ever done in my life is walk into the coffee shop of the Holiday Inn at 11 years old and walk over to the booth where the 17-year-old Bridget Baslin was sitting and hold a piece of paper and ask her to sign it, which she did. And the saddest thing in my life is after about 3 decades, I can't find it anymore. If you have seen it. I don't know, Dorothy, if you even know this, but she had a very irresistible dance as Salome in King of Kings that cost John the Baptist his head. You may not know she's from Fond du Lac, Wisconsin. Did you know that? And she is also buried in Fond du Lac, Wisconsin. She died rather young. I propose a road trip at some point in the not too distant future. The latest book of Dorothy's is Babe, which is available back there. Many other books as well, widely published, winner of a lot of awards, editor-in-chief of Honey Literary, a literary arts organization built by women of color, which I think she was just involved in a meeting of right before we got here. I will also say that if I had to care, the first time I ever introduced Dorothy, I mentioned that her poems had a lot of food and sex in them. And then I was thinking, well, she's going to be really maybe taken aback if she wasn't offended at all. That's what the poems were. So, anyway, Dorothy Chan.
Thank you all for being here. Let's start with a triple sonnet. And this is a triple sonnet for my favorite character on Riverdale, the one and only Veronica Lodge. Triple sonnet for Veronica Lodge's tigers. There are too many poems about fathers, or not enough. I used to hate mine until I remembered the fortune teller's theory that my father and I are symbols of each other. Maybe this is why, in my dreams, I say goodbye to him last whenever I go on a mission across the river, where a tiger father and a snake daughter who aren't supposed to get along, the insistence of tigers that they're the leaders of the zodiac, the secrecy of snakes, like how the idea of living a discreet life resonates so much with queer little me. A lover asks, if my father knows that I've kissed girls, I tell him that men don't need to know everything. Tiger dads are always the most. Or is the magical four-letter word actually best in this case? As a child, I took home the gold from math competitions, used the four numbers on the card to create 24. I'd watch other kids cry when they lost their rounds. Stoic little me staring at their tears, their mothers hugging them, saying they could now leave and go to McDonald's. How sad is it to lose and eat McNuggets is a feeling I'll never know, because my dad was always the last person I said goodbye to before rounds. My lucky symbol, two rivers cross. I don't want to get all Freud up in here, but my mother and I get along better in life, while my father and I get along best in dreams, both real and imagined. In Kowloon, he takes me to the McDonald's, where he won a gold pen when he was a young man. Tiger dads only breed winners. And more stories where I inherit qualities from my dad, his high alcohol tolerance, his habit of 4 hours of sleep a night, the assumption of authority everywhere I go, the raw ambition, and I feel like Veronica Lodge in that episode when she visits the guidance counselor who tells her that Veronica and her dad Hiram are parallels of each other. Like Veronica, I'm the desirable girl walking around like I own the place whose father would buy me a baby tiger if he could, pushing me to win at life. And thank you, Max, for that beautiful introduction just now. It was nice to look back at those days. Triple sonnet for Asian girlfriends, cancel my membership. The Asian Girlfriends of White Guys Club is a membership I never want to renew, so cancel my car. I need space in my juicy couture wallet, and according to dating sites, girls who look like me get the most action. But what else is new when some dudes rant at Miguel who tells that Asian girls are more fuckable with their tight-ass pussies, the sideways vagina, holy grail breakfast specials, and old men, stop with your war stories. Get away from my tight-ass pussy. Let me protect her with the world's finest lingerie, and I pose in front of the mirror, snapping photos the way painters used to eye-fuck their muses. But I'm my own damn muse, thank you very much. And I crave seduction, remembering how I played Aphrodite in an elementary school play, how I bemoaned that role, because what's up with the goddess of love in Aries? Who would be attracted to war, to rage, to incest? And why does every girl end up with either angry guy Aries or ugly guy Hephaestus when she's the prize herself? And Vanna White, let me spin that damn wheel again, or whatever game show we're on when I get to choose another door. And where is my golden Dalmatian, or my endless supply of cotton candy ice cream, or my vacation to Tokyo? And you bet your ass I'm taking a friend, not a lover, because what is love? And you've hurt me once more. And you've hurt me once more. No, I don't want Mihao. I don't want masculine hands on my thigh. I don't want a masculine hand holding my hand. A 10-inch height difference is only cute for a month. After that, my neck hurts from trying to hug you. I don't want a score when we're eating dim sum. I don't want ice water when we're eating dim sum. Get your hands off my tatsubao. Like, are you actually cute? Or are Western dating standards telling me you're the ideal man? The Adonis to my Aphrodite, and wait, I've got the myth wrong, but who really cares? This next one is a prose poem titled Designer, and it's actually part of a longer sequence from my forthcoming book with deep vellum titled Return of the Chinese Femme. Designer, like a drug, a power femme with an Ivy League degree, the mini handbag she carries, containing one stick of gum, one condom, one pen, and a credit card. Though cash is the easiest getaway, leave the 20 and let's run, baby. Once a man at Cornell asked 19-year-old me what brand of handbag he could buy me. Miu Miu, me. I hate it when rich white men call women materialistic. She's after your money, hand it over now, please. Please. The word lovers should say more. Please, as RSVP, please put on the blindfold now. Please, may I come in and shut the door and give you the best head of your life tonight. Please, baby, I'll slip off my pink panties. Please, as I'm sure for a pleasure, as in what Charlotte York, before she was York Golden Black, denied in the episode when the power lesbians come hungry for lunch, and she was tired of her men in her designer Prada loafers. Designer, like the lesbian queen bee with her Athena sculpture in the foyer, saying to sweetheart Charlotte, if you're not going to eat pussy, you're not a dyke. And Charlotte, honey, no, you didn't earn a seat at this table. Take your designer loafers and go home. Designer, like a tablecloth magic trick we do before fucking on the table. I think of this dream, the centerpieces of lemons and glassware in China stocked with the finest matcha cakes filled with red bean from Japan, sliding off, you sliding into me like a Baroque painting. And that part about cash being the easiest giveaway was actually from the great poet Richard Sykin, who is one of my poetry vets who published Attack of the 50-Foot Centerfold. So that's one of his many tips in life, you know? Always bring cash is the easiest getaway. This next poem describes the ideal relationship. Ode to sitting courtside at a Lakers game. The ideal relationship is courtside at a Lakers game, chowing on three hot dogs, extra relish and mustard, because life is about seeing and being seen, taking me back to the MTV childhood when Carmen Electra was voted most pause-worthy female, and the language was all wrong, but she was so right in declaring life wasn't worth living unless there was a camera around. How Lala Anthony called her a smart girl, and who would ever be in denial? I could be your attention whore, your millennial cam girl, your straight no chaser brat. I tell a lover on Christmas after he requests a sex tape as his gift, and I read stories of women showering ahead of time, throwing on enough eyeliner and mascara, the camera trick, the narrative we set in our lives. We all want to look beautiful on command, but what about connection? I picture when in bed after that call, V is for very, very sexy. V is for the video burn to DVD burn to Blu-ray burn to a streaming service near you. And it's strange to live through more than one decade. V is for Ver, the color of celebrity kitchens nowadays. And I dream of getting pounded right on the counter next to the bowl of fruits, or how in college we'd stare at Cezanne and call it very, very sexy attention to detail. These fruits, those oranges, that attention to detail, and undress me like a peach because V is the letter madmen once were most afraid of, questioning if women would ever fly virgin air or buy products that started with the letter V, when we all know how virginity is a social construct. And the question isn't when did she lose her virginity, but when did she gain her sexuality, or when did her sexuality come into full play? It's vulva, not vagina, that gives pleasure. According to blonde women, a candle can smell like a vagina. According to brunette women, the modifier for the vagine shouldn't be masculine, but feminine. But I like to be called bro, is what I'd say back. A man tells me I'm not very butch after I tell him I'm into feminine women, vacant. V is for versatility and serving up some realness. Every day is the beauty pageant of the Monopoly game. V is for vendetta, or the comic book you draw me in, or how King Queen Violet Chachki once said, drag was the art of not looking like a woman, but a drawing of a woman. V is for Vanessa Williams playing woman Wilhelmina Slater on Ugly Betty, having hot sex with her hunk of a bodyguard right before her wedding to the old man. If you were sitting courtside at the Lakers game, would your bodyguard block everyone else's view? I sure hope not. Pass me a hot dog. Like the apartment number you memorize, like your favorite item on the lunch menu, like your choice in the vending machine, pizza combos, or salt and vinegar chips, or tropical Skittles, or I'm thirsty for cherry Coke, hand over your cash, a cherry Coke over my breast. An older man once said, your poetry is like Frank O'Hara's, only sexier. I took that as a compliment. I'm not sure how I feel now. I hate ellipses. They're too much unearned suspense. A cherry Coke with vanilla ice cream to share. Two cherries equals a double scoop, a double dish, the double dish. The painting with the twin cherries wearing panties. The dish would like to order two dishes, lobster stuffed salmon and linguine with clams. Twin cherries, as in the slot machine I played with at the age of 10 before security in Vegas scolded me. 34D as in Victoria's secret compartment. 34D as in Victoria's transphobic as hell, so stop paying her. Her secrets are basic and boring. 34D as in bedazzle my bra. D as in the almost failing grade. But who's the teacher? I petition for the A. I'll do my extra credit and make it a plus. 34D as in God is blessed, Wilhelmina Slater and Ugly Betty for using her measurements as her safe combo. Lock and key, show off your assets. 34D as in coverage, but take it off. 34D as in uncover roaming costs. 34D as in the wandering eyes. 34D as in what does sex have to do with poetry? Everything and nothing. Let's switch it up. I'll read one. This is one of my shorter poems from Babe, and thank you to my best friend Tina Bamberg, who's not here, who was the first reader of this poem. Compulsory heterosexuality. For the third time, I will not be attending your wedding. Heterosexual romance is not the great female adventure all the movies make it out to be. Why would I walk down the aisle with a groomsman I'm not attracted to, in an ugly Grecian dress you picked out for me, because my breasts are too big for the other, shorter style? How many times can I refuse the tuxed up man post-ceremony, since we're set up as the default straight pairing? Did you ever think about how you were once a baby, relying on your mother's milk? The first party I attended in college was called Jock's Luck April. Why do men only know how to wear blue? The police are now banned from Pride. Can we ban them from everything else too? Do you even care? There's much more to life than monogamy, is something a smart friend once said. And that smart friend plays a big role in this next poem. This poem is for the Dr. Rita Mukherjee, who is my partner at Honey Literary and my partner in life. Triple sonnet for charging admission. Rita says I need to charge admission because my dress keeps riding up during a performance. And that's what I call art. That's what I call power. That's what I call walking into the room in the nude and Alexa plays something that takes me to the pink section of the nail salon, also known as Yenna's favorites, also known as the pink pussy section, orgasm on the cheeks in the greatest shade of all time, and thanks to you, and you, and of course you. And aren't fingers the most delicate feature on a femme other than the collarbone? And I love it when celebutants are asked what their favorite body part is, and they all point to their collarbone like it's some kind of hot girl secret code and brush on some highlighter there, ladies. I love nuance, like a whiff of coconut milk cream, also known as not giving it all away. But baby, if you want to give it all away, I don't blame you. I won't blame you if you want the margins of the room, skirt riding up, feeding ice cream to an audience member, and save a little for me. Why don't you? And I love nuance, or how in Art History 200, we're taught to study the way artists painted the hands of their muses, or in the words of a boy band, do you want to hold her hand? Does she come alive out of the canvas? And I think of Raphael's La Fornarina, Margherita Lute holding up that gossamer fabric over her breast, and oh, that smirk, and oh, that look into the camera. My heart pounds for her, and I think, wow, she really knew what was going on, didn't she, Raphael? Raphael's name on fabric over her arm. And I heard he was the dreamy Renaissance guy, marking his paintings with one look into the audience because, in the words of today, having a camera makes life just a little more worth living, which is a wise saying by a wise woman. And Rita says, I need to charge admission because my dress keeps riding up during a reading, and all I have to say is buy a ticket. Baby, I own it. I own you. Thank you.
There's some water there. For each of you. So that road trip to Bridget Baslin is going to be interesting. So I just want to give, there's a little bit of a chance here to talk. Some things came about because, you know, V is also for voice. I'm just wondering about when you I guess, began to write, I'm going to ask Dorothy this and then Angie this, did you feel like you were writing from a particular voice, and has that voice changed? And how do you think of that idea of voice? Because I know some people start imitating a voice that's maybe not theirs. I'm just interested in how you think about that, Dorothy, again.
Thank you for that question, Max. My voice has always been 1,000% mine. I like this question, though, because I think I have met poets and writers who are afraid to write in their own voices. And as we know, as poets, voice is really the cornerstone and the most important ingredient in the entire poem, no matter what type of poet someone is. But my voice has always been mine, yes.
Okay. How about you, Angie, in terms of, do you feel like a voice in your poem? I know you some of your poems were from another point of view to some extent, and I wonder about how you think of that idea of voice.
Let me think about that. So, I think as a young poet at Drake, I was imitating other people. And then Jody Swilke said to me, why don't you write about this particular thing? And I think that's when I started to do that. I don't know, like when I think about who I've been as a poet, it's changed in the 20s and the 30s and the 40s and now the 50s, right? But I think it's always been me. And even if I do use different point of views, it's still me. But sometimes I get tired of certain things, so I just play with it. But I don't think, you know, growing up in Iowa, I found myself on the page. Poetry helped define who I was. I started writing at the age of 7. And growing up in an all-white community, 99%, you know, poetry was what I found. And so my early journals, that's probably a different voice, but I don't know.
Well, I would like to add to that, based upon my vast amount of research this afternoon. I think I read somewhere that you started writing really, really early.
Yeah.
After reading about a mouse poet.
Yeah.
And I'm just going to ask Dorothy the same thing about the earliest part of your introduction to poetry. Like, what's on that? I mean, okay, you can just tell me what I mean by that.
Okay, so Frederick the Mouse was written by Leo Leone, big child, book. And that book showed me at the age of 7 that poetry had a particular power. And while all the other little mice were gathering food for the winter, he was collecting colors and thoughts, and so the story goes, they eat all their food. Of course, they're making fun of the little mouse poet, and when they're out of food, they ask about, what about your store? So he reads them poems, and they begin to feel well-fed and loved and warm, and they forget about the cold and the whatever was coming at them. So it taught me the power of poetry at a very early age, and I wanted to be a writer from the age of 7. So actually, I have all my journals from that time to now. I have no children, so I don't know who's going to take them. But it taught me the power, and my books were read to us every night, so it was instilled in me. It never occurred to me I couldn't be a writer or a poet, and so here I am. But I think I'm a little more mellow now. I don't know why.
Dorothy, about your first introduction to poetry or your ideas as a child. I mean, I'm talking about earliest influences that you can remember.
I was really happy tonight to hear some of Angie's ekphrastic pieces because I think that ekphrasis is so powerful. And I do believe that as a child, my first love for just the arts in general was visual art. So I would always just be like painting and drawing, and I took a lot of like visual art lessons as a kid. And I did really have that privilege because my parents, who are immigrants from Hong Kong, worked very hard so that I could have these opportunities. I was first published, I think, when I was like 14 or something in some like local journal. I wrote a poem that was in the voice of like a piano because at the time I was taking music lessons.
You also mentioned, I thought I heard the phrase poet dad. Did you say that? Okay. Well, that brings me to influences about mentors. Both of you, you know, studied as undergraduates and in graduate programs, and I'm wondering, you were at Cornell and then later as well at other places. So I'm wondering about particular people who, I don't know, were important to you at various parts of your life as mentors.
Yeah, Max, I have the best poetry family tree. I should draw a little diagram for you. But my poet dad is Norman Duby. My poet, I guess I'll say mom, I don't think she likes this word, but my poet mom from Cornell would be Lyra Van Cleef Stefanin. Please do check out her books, Open Interval and Black Swan. One of the most important poets of our time, one of the most important Black woman poets of our time. My poetry uncle is the great Alberto Rios, current poet laureate of Arizona, and watch a show on PBS. I heard it's great. He loves doing shows. Yes, also my poetry dad later on was, for a brief period of time I was publishing my first full length, was Richard Sykin. And then other members of my family would probably be also Alice Fulton from Cornell. And then I guess in the immediate poetry family, I am very, very lucky to have just so many good friends really just changing the game in poetry. Those people would probably include my partner, Dr. Rita Mukherjee, everyone else at Honey Literary, Asia St. Germain is in the audience, my mentee. I'm very, very happy to see my colleague and good friend, Dr. Jose Alvergoy in the audience, love his poetry, and Gustavo Barahano Lopez, love Gustavo's poetry as well. Let's add on to that. Keith S. Wilson, Alan Cesaro, Tana Mambrick, Jessica Q. Stark, Diamond Ford, etc. And I think that's American poetry.
Well, okay. We've got to work down to third and fourth cousins, I appreciate that answer. Angela, you don't have to go quite as far, but if you want, you're welcome.
I would say, as an undergrad, it was being introduced to Allen Ginsberg's work, Stanley Clements, and Carolyn Farché, who I think her work had a real impact on me, just because it was very political to read The Country Between Us. And then later on, I studied at the Institute of American Indian Arts, and my mentors would be Sharon Batsui, Santi Fraser, Jonah Vaya Kane, and John Davis. I'm very fortunate to be surrounded by a lot of poets, and to count them as friends. So Margaret Roska is someone who I've collaborated with over time, and she's a dear friend, and she told me she's writing the best poems in her 70s, which I think is so cool. So. I don't know, I think I look back at my time at IAIA and the people that I went to school with, Joaquin Tuantanejo, who's now the Dallas Poet Laureate and the first, his work is phenomenal. I would say Beatrice Zizkamoniak, who writes in English, but her first language is French. Her work's been vastly important to me. So I would say, yeah, there's no way that you can subtract from poetry. It only grows and grows and grows. So the more you're around, the more you read. But Wisconsin has a very vibrant poetry scene, as you know. And so I think of this like triangle between Chicago and Milwaukee and La Crosse and here as well and Madison. And there's so many poets. And it's really hard not to be moved. And I'm sure I'm gonna go and write something in the vein of Dorothy when I go home later.
Well, that's interesting because sometimes taught poetry a while, and sometimes it's hard to convince young poets, beginning poets, that they have to love somebody, they have to love some poet, whether it's some of the people you mentioned. You have to fall in love with poetry, and you have to fall in love, in order to do so, it has to be, you have to fall in love with some poets, you have to, and you might move on from that, but that's sometimes hard to convince for young poets about, but it's evident from what both of you said that that love came first or simultaneously with your own, the progression of your own growth and the importance of poetry. I remember kind of one little nuts and bolts. We don't have too much more time left, but I just want to like ask one nuts and just as a poet, and we have a lot of other poets here and other writers, but just, I mean, I know each of you could write a book about this, but any little snippet of information about revision that you could have. I mean, I know we all want to stand up and say, never touch this poem. It's flowing out of me like water. That's it. But that's not always the case. I'm just wondering how important that is to you, Dorothy.
My poetry uncle, Alberto Rios Tito, has the best revision advice. And I think that I'll just talk about his favorite quote of mine is this, or one of his many favorite quotes of mine is this: the best line of the poem is the line that I am reading, and that does not exclude the title. And so in relationship to revision, it means that every single line of your poem has to be the strongest line of the poem, and the poem, including the title, is not done until all of that happens.
Bear that in mind.
Yeah, I totally agree, because when I help you, I'm like, your strongest line, every poem, every line should be as good as your strongest line, right? Just out there. I forgot to mention Arthur Z, whose work I love as well, who also taught at IAIA. If you don't know Arthur Z, Chinese-American poet, he has this theory, every line is a poem, and it's a really wonderful thing to play with. But revision to me is the real writing. It is easy for me to write quickly and fast. As a young person, I started writing. I was supposed to be going to bed, but I'm writing and I'm under the covers. So I learned to write very quickly before my parents came and got me and told me to turn the light off. So that is the easy thing. But it's the revision that I really, really love. And I love to revise an entire collection. That is where I really enjoy it. And the poems that I read to you from In Light, Always Light and My People Redux were probably edited 20 to 30 times. There are two poems in my entire life that came out full board. Nothing else was done to them. Everything else has been played with numerous times. So I really like to go all out too with color coding sounds and I count my syllables and lines. So that to me is the best time.
Well, I think you've given us all a lot of homework tonight. I kind of whittled things down because I maybe talked too much and introduced you too long, but I'm going to ask you each to read a final poem to leave us with, and then we will go back and have some time to converse and buy some of these books and grab them home and finish your homework. Yes.
Do you want us to sit here or go up there?
Just come up here if you like.
Okay.
It doesn't matter to me.
Okay.
Whichever place you feel more comfortable. I know it puts you on the spot, like, what's the poem that every line of which is perfect? But as long as you do that, you're fine. Yes. Who went first?
We did.
So why don't you go first?
Yes. Triple sonnet for being a queer in a family of straights. If my family had a reality television show, I'd jet off the minute my scene was over, ready for fried chicken and milkshakes on a plane with a secret lover. Both of us in short skirts, our tops wrapped in pink first, because why do more than what's contractually obligated on a show that glorifies straight people and their straight drama? How many proposals and weddings and kitchen talks and breakdowns in the middle of Kowloon, Hong Kong can one season even handle? Or what about the finale of the summer when I arrive at the 8-course family dinner and a young man's waiting for me and I came hungry, just not for him? And this is a scam. This is a setup. This is a get me out of here ASAP because I clearly don't fit. This is straight people who just happen to be my family mocking me by inviting a complete stranger to dinner. And how boring is he with his startup and finance degree as he blabs on and on and on while I'm trying to eat my garlic lobster? Dear producers, stop scamming me for ratings. I know you want me pregnant with this man's baby by the middle of next season so you can plan the primetime weighing special, and how scandalous, a baby out of wedlock. The perfect straight family drama that'll be solved with this proposal, filled with red and pink roses and a jazz band playing in the park, but I'll say no. And Edward, I've just wasted your money, or did I? I'm worth every penny, baby, and I'm a spoiled brat, a secret camera whore, because do you know what it feels like to be the hottest one who's labeled single out of family spite and sibling rivalry? And I've got no time for that, ready to jet up with a secret lover to Singapore for a waterfall photo shoot. And don't you go chasing us there, our tight bikinis and one-piece cutouts. And none of this is for ratings. We're just trying to live our lives. And hello, prime time. Your formula is so straight and stale. But what would you know? Basic cable, you've got no idea what you're going to see.
Sometimes I hear sounds before I hear the poems. So this poem, I heard this sound. And this is the poem that came. It's called What in That? What woman picked the corn, split the husk, and molded the seed that fed the people and opened the world? What being climbed down the tree, made the savannah a refuge? Who caught the strife that lit the bush, that started the spark, that became the flame, that lit the hearth, and traveled village to village? Hollowed horn of smoldering smoke that started the fire, that cooked the kill, that fed the self to grow so big. What worker burned the child, cut the cord, swaddled it, and kept on going down her road? What mother walked thousands of miles with two hands held in those smaller than her own? What father carried his child over mountaintops, swam through rivers, crossed deserts and lakes with one arm? What prisoner pierced the log, walked out into the sunshine? What grandparent let her daughter sleep while the child rose, bathed its skin in rosewater and lavender, sang songs of ones and twos until it cooed back, ohs and ahs, blowing bubbles? What woman picked the corn, split the husk, and spilled the seed that fed the people and opened our world? Thank you.
Thank you, and Angie, and also thank the many people who aren't up here but made this festival possible, made this reading possible. It takes, I used to only have writers and musicians as my heroes because that's who I idolized. After giving a number of readings and being in a number of events like this, I realized how many people it takes to put it together, who get very little credit and are paying and doing it for no money whatsoever, and yet they're the reason we come here and the reason that we can sell books and the reason that they help. They're helpers. And that's what we need more of. I'm happy to also have this night that we sit here and we listen to poetry, which, in my opinion, is the distance between who we are, what we feel, and what we think, and what we can say. And that we've heard that distance bridged poem after poem after poem tonight. Please say hello to the poets and ask the questions you really want to ask, and buy some books and get them signed at the end. And thank you all for coming. And there's a whole lot of festival left after this. Thank you.